This video is sponsored by Notion. One of the world's most controversial and ambitious megaprojects worth $1 trillion recently went from paper to construction site. I'm talking about The Line, a 100-mile-long, 660-foot-wide, 1,640-foot-tall mirrored city being built in the middle of the Saudi Arabian desert. Most people thought it was a crazy idea, a pipe dream full of conceptual art that would never be built. And yet, here we are. What's this project all about? Can it really work? And what does it mean for you and me? This project is mired in controversy. There's all sorts of issues stemming from Saudi Arabia to begin with and everything else. But I think there's enough of an engineering angle here to make it interesting. And I think there's going to be things that we can learn from this project. But let's find out. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. Saudi Arabia is the largest oil exporter in the world and holds almost one-fifth of the world's proven oil reserves. Oil represents 80% of the country's exports, accounting for almost half of the country's GDP. This dependency on oil creates a big problem for countries like Saudi Arabia, since it makes their economies rely heavily on fluctuating oil prices and demand. The Saudis know this full well, and it's why the Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman created the country's long-term development roadmap, dubbed Saudi Vision 2030. The plan is a strategic framework meant to diversify the Saudi economy, reduce its oil dependency, and create a new vibrant and thriving Arab society, or at least that's the plan. In 2017, as part of this Vision 2030, Crown Prince unveiled plans to build a $500 billion megaproject called NEOM during a Future Development Initiative conference. This project, if that wasn't ambitious enough, was later expanded to $1 trillion. So what is NEOM? NEOM, which means New Future, it's a massive infrastructure development project that spans 10,000 square miles in the northern Tabuk region of Saudi Arabia bordering the Red Sea. It's actually a collection of four main megaproject. Trojena, Oxagon, a collection of luxury island destinations in the Red Sea, and the flagship megacity project, The Line. The Line is pitched as a futuristic linear city, starting in the Red Sea's coast and stretching approximately west to east in a 106-mile-long straight line. The line crosses four different ecologies, including coastal regions, a desert, the Habul Alaz mountain range, and ends in the valley beyond. The city will be sandwiched between two flat parallel vertical facades 500 meters tall, almost as tall as the One World Trade Center in Manhattan, completely covered in mirrors. The top of the structure will be open to allow outside air to naturally flow in, creating a controlled microclimate. Inside the 200-meter-wide space between the outer walls would be the city itself. This whole city is actually designed as part of a series of modular segments they refer to as unique communities that contain all the services and amenities that a person would need to live comfortably within a 5-minute walking distance. In principle, you wouldn't need to move any further than your unique local community to satisfy your every need, so there's no need for cars in the line. This, they claim, will make the city completely carbon-free with no emission. The way they plan to accomplish this is by organizing the layout into this new three-dimensional concept in urban planning they call zero-gravity urbanism. And this is where my engineering mind starts screaming inside my head, especially because what they've been showing so far is a series of concepts and animations with entire inverted forests suspended hundreds of feet in the air with huge trees growing upside down. More on that in a minute. City functions will be divided into three main layers. A lower spine layer with all the main transport systems that interconnect the different communities. A service layer on top that will be run mostly autonomously and will be invisible to most people. And a pedestrian layer where people will, well, walk around and live their life. But all that being said, it is really hard to figure out just from these renderings, which are pretty much the only real source of public information, just exactly what the line is going to be. But it does seem that only the pedestrian layer is above ground, and it includes all the actual buildings encased within the mirror facade. Upon completion, the line is expected to house 9 million residents in a 34 square kilometer footprint. That's roughly the same population as New York City, but occupying less than a 20th of the total surface area. So one of the key perks that got me interested is that the line will be a car-free city, a truly well thought out and designed community that wouldn't need cars like most cities today. Most movement will happen vertically as we move from one building to another that's stacked on top of each other. This, of course, will require thousands of elevators and escalators and other levels of complexity. If we want to move around further, there will be an ultra high-speed transit system that's supposed to get you from one end of the line to the other in just 20 minutes. Meanwhile, here in California, 10 years later and billions of dollars over budget, we have very little progress on our rapid lines, but I'm sure they could probably do it. That means that this transit system will be faster than any other built to date, since it would have to travel around 317 miles an hour, considering all the time it would take and all the speeding up and slowing down between each stop. Based on these requirements, the system that most likely would fit would be Elon's Hyperloop, which could reach theoretical speeds of 700 miles an hour, but so far in prototype form has only reached about 288 miles an hour. Oh, I just remembered I had a great idea for a future video, and this is a perfect opportunity to tell you about our sponsor this week, Notion. Notion is one of my favorite tools, and Tuba DaVinci runs on Notion, and it has for the past 3 years. It's like the ultimate powerhouse productivity tool with amazing databases, views, and so much more. Seriously, here is our master list of video ideas, and here's a look at our calendar view. I'm serious when I say we run on Notion. And now in the golden age of AI, we have Notion AI built right into Notion. And I use it for creating outlines and even writing entire paragraphs in our scripts. Just hit spacebar in any Notion workspace to summon the AI to brainstorm ideas. Like, how about batteries? It'll even create outlines and write essays. Or how about writing entire blog posts? Now, everything you're seeing here is real-time, real-world, live demos. So yeah, it's pretty amazing. I just did some writing on induction cooktops. How about a pros and cons list? And seriously, this is just the beginning. Whether it's being more organized in your personal life, planning a group vacation, or running your business, you're gonna absolutely love Notion and Notion AI. Get started with Notion for free and unlock the power of Notion AI for only $10 a month. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Notion and you for supporting the show. For shorter trips, Saudi Arabia already invested $175 million in the company Volocopter to develop and manufacture air taxis that will carry people around the city. The first 15 aircraft should be in the air by 2024. I don't think that's probably going to happen, but I digress. We'll get back to my opinions here shortly. Another key trait of the line is that it will work with 100% renewable energy coming from solar and wind, both of which are abundant in Saudi Arabia. But their bet is more like the Japanese, since they're also building a $5 billion green hydrogen plant with the American company Air Products and Chemicals, which will be the biggest in the world. How about water? Well, water would have to be supplied by desalinating the Red Sea, since there's literally no surface water in the entire country, no rivers or lakes. That's one of the unique things about Saudi Arabia. There are several new promising desalination technologies being developed, like a series of huge solar heated domes made by the UK-based Solar Water Pick. It'll be the first of its kind, so fingers crossed. All right, so that's water, electricity. How about food? Well, food is a little bit trickier because they don't really have much to say about it just yet. Since there's nothing really in the region, no farmland or anything else, all the food would need to be either produced in the city or shipped in from somewhere else. The project does integrate vertical farming throughout the structure, which should be a stable source of food, but they don't say much in the way of stable sources of animal protein or livestock. By now, we've discussed most of the more or less specific details of the mega project, but the line is also supposed to include some rather bizarre features. The most notorious of which, besides the inverted forest that are going to grow upside down, is a fake moon made out of drones. I mean, why do they even need that? We have the real moon and there's going to be no roof on this structure. But apart from that, you can expect a mechatronic Jurassic Park and, wait for it, robot boxing. Real steel style. So that's pretty much what we know about the line. But that doesn't really answer the question of why is Saudi Arabia building it in the first place? As I mentioned a minute ago, NEOM is supposedly a way for them to diversify their economy and to make it less dependent on oil revenue. And I think we can all be in favor of that because any country that really leans into oil today isn't looking very good for a future where oil is going to become rarer and less needed. Real estate development and tourism are two promising industries that have already been proven to work well in Dubai. But more than that, the plan is to attract business in a big way. The line is located strategically in the center of major global trading route, being 8 hours or less away from almost 70% of the world population. There are already direct flights from NEOM to London and Dubai, with many more coming as the city grows. The line will be a free trade zone with its own autonomous judicial system, which is important considering that Saudi Arabia's government has a pretty sketchy reputation regarding civil liberties, freedom of speech, labor laws, and women's rights. But will these new laws be more open? And what does a judicial system that's autonomous mean? And who programs it? Especially if it's coming from a totalitarian regime. Those are things that we're gonna have to just wait and see. So let's start breaking down this project. The first question to pop into my head when I saw the promotional video was, why cover the whole thing in mirrors? The mirrors will reflect part of the scorching desert sunlight away from the facade, keeping the inside cooler. This will be necessary to keep the line from turning into a huge solar oven, but it still has some serious drawbacks. A glass facade in the desert is challenging for several reasons. Covering this huge wall with mirrors is not only expensive, by reflecting so much incident sunlight back out, what would that mean for local wildlife, birds, and other animals? Second, mirrors will need cleaning and replacing, especially after the desert sand wears them down. Considering each facade will have a surface area of roughly 1 billion square feet, equivalent to over 30,000 football fields covered with mirrors on each sides of the line, there will be huge maintenance costs involved. Just imagine what cleaning those mirrors will be like. It takes 36 workers 3 months to clean the outside of the Burj Khalifa, which has around 1.2 million square feet of glass. The line would be almost 2,000 times as much. Then again, perhaps it'll all be automated, Roomba style. The next question is, why a line? A circle, for example, makes so much more sense because it would be way more efficient. It makes everything closer and allows the construction of multiple transport systems that don't need to be theoretical hyperloops. And with a 1,600-foot tall wall shielding the center of the desert, they could make a real oasis in the middle. Making it a line seemingly doesn't make sense to me. I've always had a hard time squaring that thought. But maybe by making it modular and making every little part of the line piece by piece, and maybe at first you only have a couple of hundred meters of the line, and maybe in 2025 you add a few more. And by doing it that way, there's a modularity impact. I'm not sure. Or maybe they're really keen on a hyperloop system. It's hard to say, but it is what it is.
The line does sound better than the circle.
The line, yeah. The line, a little more catchy than the circle. That's a fair point. Then there's the issue of the Earth's curvature. Is the city going to be truly a straight line, or will it have a bit of a bend to allow for the Earth's curvature? Unless you're a flat earther, then just ignore this part and fast forward. The latter is the most logical option, because drawing a straight line from one end of the globe to another will obviously pass through the ground, and in this case, it'll sink about 1,800 feet below the surface at the center. So more than a line, it should probably call it the arch. Another issue with being a line going east to west would be sunlight. Since the city will be located at approximately 28 degrees latitude, it is very close to the Tropic of Cancer, meaning that the midsummer, the sun is almost directly above the line, shining down in all of its glory until dawn or dusk. But during most of the rest of the year, sunshine will always be hitting it at an incident angle from the south, leaving the northern side of the line pretty constant and shady throughout the day. I'm also wondering if the city would realistically produce its own food. This is going to be a big concern in the middle of the desert. Yeah, you can add solar, you can make electricity, but food is a challenge. The world's biggest vertical farm is in Dubai, and it produces about 2 million pounds or about 1,000 tons of leafy greens every year using a total of 330,000 square feet of real estate. The average American adult eats around 2,000 pounds, around 1 ton of food every year, so the line would need to produce around 9 million tons of food annually to feed its target population. That's the equivalent of 3 billion square feet or around 106 square miles of vertical farm, taking up an entire 8 levels of the whole city. This shouldn't be too much of a problem considering that there will be about 100 stories in total. So 8 stories out of 100 to feed all those people. But it'll also require a ton of energy. Vertical farms mean you have shade on each level and you have to provide its own LED grow lights and stuff. And how about at night? You have to have batteries. There's as many questions as there are answers at this point, probably. So apart from that, there are also questions about the danger of fires or infectious disease spreading inside the line. And what about earthquakes? A rigid structure this size is unlikely to survive even a minor earthquake. It would have to be flexible enough to withstand such forces. And what about the wind? The wind is going to be a challenge in this region of the world, and it is a major issue with slim towers and large structures with huge amounts of surface area. If the whole thing starts vibrating and reaching its resonant frequency because of the wind, it'll shatter into a million pieces, especially with all that glass. But all of these issues aside, the fact that the line has actually already started construction really does mean something. They have a team of world-class architects and engineers who probably know what they're doing. Yeah? No? So maybe they've already thought of every one of these problems and they have solutions and they'll share them with us in the coming years. So that's a look at the NEOM line and their progress. Look, I know there's a lot of different directions we can go with this, but ultimately what I think is cool is they're actually trying it. There's some innovation, they're trying new things, and there's going to be lessons learned. And maybe other countries will do similar things or maybe not. In a lot of ways, I'm almost thinking they're terraforming, right? It's kind of like the first foray into learning how to build habitats on Mars, maybe, because the temperatures and the weathers that they have and the lack of resources is very inhospitable. Maybe not Mars level, but there's sure to be things that we can learn from this. So much of urban planning is just individual homes. We don't really think about larger building blocks of a city. Las Vegas comes to mind as a perfect example. I don't think when they built Vegas pretty recently, like in the 50s, that they planned it would become the big monstrosity that it is today. And as a result, it's really hard to get around. During CES, to go from one convention to another convention, like a mile away, it took like 45 minutes because the road traffic was so bad. They should have trains that run underground all day long. They don't. You know why? Because they didn't plan it. Poor planning is at the heart of a lot of our issues that we face. And if this line and the mirrors and the glass and all these complex things that seem kind of crazy pan out, well, you can imagine how much heating and cooling costs would be required for each individual house. Could it be worth it on a bigger scale? Are there other pros and cons or trade-offs? That's the sort of stuff I think we need to learn. It's just like when a company builds a new aircraft. It's very ambitious, very risky, that takes a lot of challenges. But at the end of the day, we have to keep moving forward. We can't just keep doing things the same way. So for that reason, I'm optimistic. And who knows, we'll try to get out there and do a video as they progress in the coming year or so. All right, that is a look at NEOM. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, check out that one next. I think you'll also like. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Rick YouTube at Da Vinci, and we'll catch you guys next week.